I've been using the names Half-Life Alyx and Half-Life 3 interchangeably, thinking that you knew what I meant. But this being the internet, many of you have leapt to your keyboards to correct me, telling me that Half-Life Alyx isn't Half-Life 3 because blah blah blah, stupid reasons, etc. But I too can be petty and pedantic, and hence, this video. Half-Life Alyx is Half-Life 3 because it's the third big Half-Life game. Some of you have been calling it Half-Life 1.5 because chronologically it's set between Half-Life 1 and Half-Life 2. But while I agree with you that three Half-Lives do indeed make 1.5, it is not Half-Life 1.5 because that would involve Valve getting strangely nostalgic, returning to Half-Life 1's engine, making large adjustments to it, like maybe adding VR support, and then making a game around that. But that is not what Half-Life Alyx is. Half-Life Alyx is bigger than that. It's bigger than Half-Life 1.5. It's bigger than 2. It might even be worthy of a 3. Tell you what, I'll humour you. Imagine that on March the 23rd, 2020, instead of Half-Life Alyx, we got Half-Life 3. What would have been different about it? Well, for a start, the story would have been set after Half-Life 2, instead of before it. You'd have played as Gordon Freeman, instead of Alyx. And there would have been less dialogue to listen to. But apart from that, nothing else would have been different. At least, nothing that would impact how good it is. It would still be Source 2. The graphics would be of a similar quality, the gameplay would have similar mechanics. Like I've said, the only thing noticeably different about it would have been the story. For argument's sake, I'm sure some of you will say that the story is what you care most about from a new Half-Life game. Well, you're in luck, because it's already out. If you don't like spoilers, then close your eyes now. Because here, on screen, is the next bit of the Half-Life story, released in 2017 by Mark Laidlaw, the writer for Half-Life. Oh, I'm sorry, you're not satisfied with that. Do you feel like something's missing? Maybe the rest of the experience? Again, you're in luck, because we're getting that next month with Half-Life Alyx. You can open your eyes again now, by the way. But Half-Life Alyx is a VR spin-off, I hear you cry. Half-Life 3 wouldn't have been VR. I disagree. Look at Valve. They have been working away in secret on VR for years. They're a company that's not afraid to scrap something that isn't up to their standards. Yet they have announced a new VR-only Half-Life game. Clearly, they believe in VR. They think it adds something to games that can't be had from a normal PC setup. The question we've got to ask isn't, will Half-Life 3 be VR, but rather, how could Half-Life 3 not be in VR? Because the only way I see them returning to the flat screen will be if VR proves to be a disastrous waste of time. I suspect, from the fact that they've announced Half-Life Alyx, that Valve already knows it won't be. And I think after the game's release, we'll know as well. I'm going to be blunt here. Virtual reality is fantastic. Put it on and within seconds you lose yourself in a virtual world. Stuff you wouldn't think anything of in normal games suddenly becomes something to obsess about, be it a swing, a 50-foot drop, or a headcrab leaping at your face. The only thing as fun as using VR is watching other people experiencing it for the first time. Get on the bandwagon early and you can be the one to give them that. I have had endless fun pushing my mum off buildings, or watching my dad abuse a dog with a bow and arrow, or watching as my granddad suddenly gets the appeal of a virtual world, as he peers about it, open-mouthed, or surprising someone with their first close-in-quarters engagement with a zombie, or watching my friend, who's an avid boxer, fearlessly take on one with a flurry of punches. I am yet to see somebody who doesn't like VR. A lot of the hate for it that I see online is probably from people who either haven't experienced it, or who are unable to buy a VR kit. And I get it, it sucks if you can't afford it. A VR headset is a big investment. The one good thing that's come from the 16 years between Half-Life 2 and now is that all my friends who have been waiting for it all that time are now adults, most with their own places and earning decent money. But even for them, a VR headset is a big investment. I can only imagine the frustration of being young or in a position where you are unable to afford it. But to hate on the technology is being short-sighted. You'd have to be blind not to see VR's appeal. Also, ignore those who claim it costs thousands of dollars, they're just ignorant. I have made a guide to help educate and to inform people of the cheapest ways of building a VR-ready rig. It isn't as expensive as you might think, but I do understand that some people will still be unable to afford it. But to demand that the next Half-Life isn't VR for that reason is to destroy how great Half-Life 3 could be. I'm actually impressed that Valve has managed to find something as controversial as VR to bundle with a new Half-Life game. I really thought that requiring an internet connection for Half-Life 2 was about as risky as they could have gone, but it's good to see that Valve can still upset so many people in the present day. Unlike Valve, I'm not afraid of calling the game Half-Life 3. I understand that if you're working at Valve, developing the sequel to Half-Life 2, you have a hell of a lot of pressure weighing down upon you. Think of the nostalgia, today's increased standards for games, the decades of memes weighing down upon you. The idea that Half-Life 3 won't live up to its impossible expectations must be terrifying. I think that's part of the reason they avoided straight up calling it Half-Life 3 and following on from where the Half-Life 2 episodes left off. I also think it's part of the reason why they went down the VR route, to stop direct comparisons with anything else out there. I think the only Half-Life game Valve could have released in 2020 that I wouldn't have considered to be Half-Life 3 had been Episode 3, and I'd have been as disappointed as everybody else if it had just turned out to be another episode of Half-Life 2. After such a long time, people expect more, and so I'm happy that the Half-Life series has gone down such an unexpected and radical route. And if you're still not convinced that Half-Life Alyx is Half-Life 3, it's on to my last and strongest argument. The idea of jumping back into the Half-Life universe in VR makes me go, yeah. You know what else makes me go, yeah? Playing Half-Life 1 for the first time. Or getting the gravity gun in Half-Life 2 and using it to pick something up. Yeah. It's the kind of cutting-edge, groundbreaking experience that will redefine what you expect from future games. It burns a vivid memory into your mind that will be there forevermore, that every time you go back to think about it, you go, yeah. You know what didn't? Those Half-Life 2 episodes. They were good, the first time I played them through from start to finish in a single session. I can't fault their quality, but they weren't magical. They were just more of the same. They didn't come with the excitement, the new technology, and the leap in quality that Half-Life 2 had come with. There was a magic to Half-Life 1 and Half-Life 2 in how they raised the bar in so many different ways that you hadn't even thought as possible before you experienced them. I remember watching those Half-Life 2 preview videos so many times, I thought I'd know exactly what it would be like to play through those sections, yet somehow, experiencing them in person was different. And incredibly, even better than I had hyped myself up for. That's the sign of the best game ever. So I'm pleased we're getting Half-Life 3, and not just another episode of Half-Life 2 with improved graphics to conclude an unfinished story. Maybe younger gamers won't know what I mean when I talk about the Half-Life magic. I'm sure that many of you will have tried Half-Life in more recent years, and will have wondered what all the fuss is about. That's because every game since them has imitated and stolen from them in some way. You're approaching them from the future, which is the wrong way, but you're in luck. You'll get to experience Half-Life 3, Alyx, in the way that I did with the older games all those years ago, as a fresh experience that will redefine what you expect from games going forward. And in 10, 20 years time, when every new game is VR, and the youth says they don't understand what made Half-Life Alyx so special, you'll find yourself in my shoes, educating them on the Half-Life magic. A new Half-Life game is as much about what comes with it as it is about the game itself. Half-Life 1 wasn't just the best game ever. It also launched Valve as a company, and the Gold Source engine encouraged modders, paving the way to games like Counter-Strike. Half-Life 2 wasn't just the best game ever either. It also came with Source and Steam. Source is a game engine still used to power games 16 years later, and Steam changed the way we bought games forever. And now Half-Life Alyx is coming with Source 2 and VR. The Half-Life series is not just about the games. It is always a big risk and used to drive new technology. Don't just see this as a ploy to sell lots of Valve Index headsets. Yes, it will do that as well, but the game will work with any modern VR device. Selling headsets is secondary to Half-Life Alyx selling the concept of VR itself. Virtual reality is in a similar state to how Steam was back before Half-Life 2 was released. Back then, digital distribution was considered niche, unnecessary, even hated by many. But thanks to Half-Life 2, people started using it. Fast forward to today, and it's hard to imagine PC gaming without Steam. It's worth billions of dollars, and loved by many. To the point where people would rather buy a product on Steam than to get it free elsewhere. Likewise, here we are in 2020, and virtual reality is seen as niche, unnecessary, and even hated by many. That's not to say there aren't already great experiences to be had on it, it's just that none of them have that mainstream appeal that's needed to draw in the masses. To take the plunge on a VR headset, and to throw away their bet. But Half-Life Alyx might be able to change that. So you see, Half-Life Alyx is more than just a spin-off, or VR curiosity. It's just as ambitious, just as risky, and just as important as Half-Life 1 and Half-Life 2 were. And VR is in dire need of it. If you had asked me a few years ago to name one game that would convince me to buy a VR headset, it would have been Half-Life 3. And sure enough, Half-Life Alyx has made me do it. And that is why I'll continue to refer to it as Half-Life 3. At least until Valve announces Half-Life 3. You may say that this is a little bit premature of me. Wouldn't it be terrible if Half-Life Alyx comes out and is a steaming pile of dog poo? These videos of mine would age like milk, and with hindsight, I'd look really, really foolish. It's not like Valve succeed with everything they do. They have an impressive list of fails, too. The Steam controller's been discontinued, and Steam machines have disappeared in a puff of steam. Remember Artifact? No, me neither. And there is a very real possibility that, for one reason or another, VR fails to take off, just as it has done so many times before, and Half-Life Alyx becomes a warning to other studios for why you don't invest so heavily in unproven technology. But I want to believe, and if that means being happy and excited about something for once, then that's a small price to pay. But Half-Life 3 being bad would break me. I'm not thinking about that because it's too horrible to imagine. These days, there are fewer and fewer games that I look forward to, and sometimes it seems like everybody else wants it to fail just for the drama that it would cause. Well, not with me. Not this time. I believe in Half-Life 3.